Welcome to the Mighty Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Johnson. We'll be talking about almost everything related to organ transplant. They say the harder rock and roll is to be. And from what I've seen, I believe them. Now the other may be barely breathing. But the harder rock and roll, harder rock and roll is to be. Trying to get the hang of this podcast thing. I'm used to doing video and realizing my voice has been a little far away from the mic and very echoey. So trying to just improve the audio quality, I'm squeezed up closer to the microphone, which will, I'm sure, give my voice a more rich and deep and engaging tone. I don't know if it'll make any difference at all, but hopefully it sounds a little better. I want to pick up where we left off in the last episode where I started talking about normalcy. So this is part two of that. If you have not listened yet to that episode, I would encourage you to go back and check that out, because I went into quite a bit of detail about the various situations my family and I were in over the last 6 years of the transplant experience. I encourage you to check that out if you haven't. Just for context, I don't know why you wouldn't have. I don't know what kind of monster would skip around listening to podcast episodes out of order. We're not animals, guys. Go back and listen to these in order, just in case you've stumbled upon this somewhere out of context. There were a variety of different situations we found ourselves in. We were on the road back and forth to various hospitals, long trips in the car, which was the first challenge, and then a lot of hotel rooms that went along with that. We lived in a different place for every 3 months while moving around with my wife's travel nursing job. She took on various contracts over about a 2.5 year period. We settled down in Springfield, Massachusetts, then moved again from there to Pennsylvania, where I spent about 2.5 years living on a cardiac ICU 2 out of every 8 weeks. And that was just a seemingly endless cycle. I had an artificial heart implanted in 2015, which meant that people, when I came home, we had to have somebody at our house with us anytime my wife left for work or even the grocery store, because I had to have someone to babysit the pump that powered the heart. And we didn't want to leave that burden on our kids, on our boys, should the worst happen. In the middle of that, I was admitted to the hospital for 5 months consecutively and lived there on the ICU for about 5 months. So the question then becomes, how do you maintain a sense of normalcy in your family when there's nothing normal or consistent about your situation? There are probably a lot of other principles that are underlying here that are really too far reaching and outside of the scope of this podcast to address in terms of family relationships and marriage relationships. In our case, I can just say that both our marriage and our relationship with our kids, even though they were really young, it was pretty solid when all this started in 2010. My wife and I had already been through my diagnosis initially. We were friends going all the way back to high school, and she struggled a lot with endometriosis and ovarian cysts, which was very painful and difficult. She'd been through 7 or 8 procedures even before we started dating, when I knew her in high school, to deal with that. We thought we couldn't have kids. We had run a business together. We'd made a mutual decision to leave public ministry, which was very, very difficult, and had kind of started life over by the time we got to all of this in 2010. So a lot of things had happened. Our youngest son, Brennan, was really, really sick from the time he was about 8 weeks old. We thought he had celiac disease, and dealt with doctors that didn't understand what was going on, and dealt with people who didn't believe that he was really sick. So we'd kind of had some experience and background in some of this. Many people will not, which is fine. But just to kind of give you an idea of where we were, my wife and I knew we could trust each other. Our kids knew they could trust us. And, you know, I want to spend some time talking about the family unit, and especially the whole parent-child relationship, in a different episode. I'm not a family counselor. I'm not a therapist. But, you know, and I don't really have advice for how to fix your family if you're not in that place, or if maybe you've got people that aren't on the same page, or you don't have support from your spouse or whatever it is. I think there's maybe some ways to repair and fix those relationships in the midst of all this that will steer things in the right direction. But I don't assert that there will be any cure for deeply dysfunctional issues or abusive relationships of any kind with substances or other people. I'm just going to have to assume that most families are at least a little bit like ours, in that whenever the news of the transplant fell, crashed in like a bomb, it was all hands on decks to get me through the thing. I know that's not the case for everybody, but that was kind of where we're at, just so there's some context here. Our boys were very young. It was 2009. Richard was 8 and Brennan was 5. I was already the primary caregiver because I'd been sick since before they were born with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but I did not know that I needed a transplant until they were that age. That's when we found out. So me suddenly needing a heart transplant did not change our home situation very much. Mom already worked. Dad was already at home. Maybe your situation is like that. It most likely is not. So some of that is going to change radically. We were already in a routine, however, both on a daily basis and a weekly basis. And the biggest part of that was really just spending time together at least a little bit every day. We, took a walk after dinner when we could, and it generated conversation. Mainly what I'm saying is because our kids were the age they were, we were tracking with each other. We didn't have teenagers coming and going and extracurricular activities, and we were homeschooling, so we weren't dealing with the public school thing and how was your day. We knew how their day was. For empty nesters, this will be a whole different thing. The point is, when our situation changed, our home life really didn't change that much. And I think if yours is, again, I have no experience with that, but I think if yours is changing, it's important for everybody involved to mutually decide what that is going to look like. That's the only thing I can think to avoid a lot of conflict in that suddenly a different parent's at home, or the dynamic has shifted and, things are just changing up. There's got to be communication instead of just one person saying, well, here's how it's going to be, and everybody's got to fall in line. That being said, it kind of just segues accidentally into the very first thing I want to say about or share about what happened with us, and the reason I believe that we were able to come through this whole thing intact and still having a really good relationship with each other, both in the marriage and in the family. And that's that our experience was shared. And I think it's probably the number one most important thing that happened for us looking back. It means that the traumas and the victories and the losses that went along with the whole thing, we shared it together. That was not purposeful, however, on our part. If I could have shipped my kids somewhere else to another set of loving, caring parents and shielded them from the anxiety and the stress of the whole thing, at the outset, I would have chosen that, no question. But owing to the fact that they were very small when this all started, and that we spent quite a bit of time away from any support system, as you know, if you listened to the last episode, at first, they were involved, whether we wanted them to be or not. As they got older, they insisted on continuing to be part of it. I can see where, had the situation been different, had they been high school kids or older, they may not have wanted to be as intimately involved as they were, because they would have had friends and other things going on, but they were invested because they grew up in it and they knew what was happening. Some of you might have the option to include your kids or not include your kids. It's going to be different for every family, whatever you decide to do. I'm just sharing what happened to us. I believe the rest of what I'm going to talk about today really followed, though, from us sharing this as a family. I think one of the reasons that families become disconnected and disjointed and all this is because you've got only the patient really intimately knowledgeable in what's happening, or it's just the parents, or it's just, the parent and one of the kids, and the spouse is just like, well, let me know when you're done with all this. And there's not really a shared experience, whatever combination of people are involved. What I'm saying is, you're going to have an inner circle of people, whether that's your parent, your sibling, an aunt, an uncle, a friend, whatever it is, that is part of the group that is intimately involved with what's going on. I would say it like this. There's going to be a point in all of this where you've had some kind of procedure or surgery, and you need to have your teeth brushed or your nose wiped, and there's not a nurse around. Who are the people who are going to be able to do that for you that you're comfortable with, and you have that kind of relationship? That's your inner circle, whether that's your kids, parents, a friend, your pastor, whatever it is. Those are the people that I'm kind of referring to here when I say they need to be involved. And they're inside the loop. Anybody that's not there at the bedside in the waiting rooms and all that is really not going to be part of that. Time spent in waiting rooms and hospital rooms, as hard as it is, being in the conversation, being part of decision making, being informed about what's going on, that's the stuff that brings people into the inner circle. It really denotes who's in that inner circle and who's not going to be part of it. No matter how much you may think that you can catch someone up or text them or FaceTime with them or fill in the blanks for them later, there's no replacement for being there right when these things are happening. And I'm fully aware that this is not possible many times with older kids. We homeschooled, our kids were young, that made it natural for us, but as much as possible. I think it's really important in terms of sharing the journey to understand that you've got to be involved. For anybody who says, hey, I want to help, I want to be part of it, well, this is what that means. There's a scene at the end of Tolkien's Lord of the Rings that I really love, and it's become, it really resonated with me and with us. Peter Jackson does a great job of portraying this in the film version in The Return of the King. It's when the four hobbits, after, unbeknownst to the people around them, they've saved the world, made terrible sacrifices, watched friends die. They've been through hardships beyond any imagining of their friends or families. And they have no idea. These people have no idea what these four hobbits have gone through. And they're sitting around the table in their hometown pub that they used to hang out at before they went on this journey. Life is just going on around them. People caught up in their daily problems that probably seem kind of irrelevant and trifles to them after everything that they've seen. And they just kind of look around. They take it all in. They share this knowing look with one another and grin a little bit, silently toast each other and, get on with it. And whoever's in your inner circle, I'm just telling you, at the end of the thing, you will no doubt have moments like that where you can just exchange a look and you will not be able to articulate what you're thinking to anyone outside of that circle. But the people in that circle will know exactly what that look means. They will know what it reminds you of, and they will know what you've been through and what the journey was like. All of those years in the waiting room and hospital rooms and the ambulance trips and all this stuff back and forth, it culminated in a shared experience for our family that belongs to us now. It's something that we own. No one else will ever be able to have a part of that. It's sacred to us, and it's a bond, like a silent bond between us. So understand that now at the outset, that if you want someone to be involved, if you're a caregiver and you want to be that person that's in that inner circle, you have to actually be there for these things. It has to be a shared experience. Secondly, and this is going to come off sounding a little old fashioned, like, well, you need to have family time, get the Monopoly board and let's all get there. And I don't mean it to sound like that. I hate that kind of stuff. But if you don't have some type of daily convention where the people in that circle are checking in with each other, your family, whoever it is, even if it's just 5-10 minutes at the end of the day, even if it has to be over Zoom or Skype or whatever, you need to establish that. The people in your inner circle need to understand, and you need to understand, that there are going to be a lot of decisions and a lot of changes in the future if you're not experiencing those already, not just about medical things, but about money, about work, about taking care of the household, kids, transportation. The list goes on and on and on. And sometimes Not all the time. There'll be seasons where it's not like that, but there are definitely periods of time where this stuff comes fast and furious. There's going to be a lot to talk about and a lot to debate about and decisions to be made. The best way to wreck your inner circle, your family, is to have a lack of communication, loss of communication, bad communication. I would strongly encourage you as a family, whatever your inner circle is, whatever that means to you, set aside that time every day until this is over, if your situation will permit it at all. That is going to mean maybe sacrificing some other things for those people, rearranging schedules a bit. But this is life and death stuff. And as I said, if people are in your inner circle, that means it's all hands on deck. And you need to have that kind of daily, or at least, you know, three or four times weekly situation where you're hopefully in a room together and discussing whatever's going on, and getting that input from them. As a side note, I would say parents, and I'll talk about this again in the parent-child episode I want to do, but for us, and I can't say maybe this is the right thing for everybody, but for us, we wanted to involve our boys in these conversations and decisions as soon as they were old enough to understand what was going on. In our view, hiding things from them, downplaying the risks, or trying to candy coat things, trying to put a happy face on the trauma and tell them that everything was going to work out, we were concerned that if things did not go well, that was going to come back to bite us and them. We felt like they needed to be prepared for what was potentially going to happen and some of the things we knew for sure were going to happen. Not by scaring them, not by lecturing them or, you know, shielding them from it and then giving them an information dump whenever they turned 16 or whatever it was. No matter how self-absorbed, no matter how detached or inexperienced or immature you may think your kids are, trust me, kids see things from a different perspective than adults do. You are going to be making some very difficult decisions going forward. And to my mind, you need as many brains in the room as you can get, especially if they're brains that you trust and who know the context of your situation. I can honestly say that I owe my life, and it's not an exaggeration, I owe my life to decisions that both of my boys convinced me to make at various times because they saw the world and they saw life in a different kind of more objective way than I was able to, being the patient in the middle of the situation. Their involvement and their input in those decisions and conversations are probably the most valuable thing that I was able to rely on at times when I myself was not sure what to do. I would encourage you to get that input, and it also serves to condition your inner circle and the kids that are in that, whoever they may be, for difficult things that may be ahead. It also helps them to know that they are valued and their opinion is valued and that you trust them. I'd strongly encourage having that conversation time and those moments as much as possible on a daily basis, if possible. That dovetails into the next thing. I don't know if I'm numbering these or not. I guess this would be number three if I am. Traditions and rituals. You need something, I feel like, or at least in our experience, we found it important to have something that serves as a flagpole, even if it's just for you and your spouse. If you're empty nesters or your kids are older, it can be anything, but preferably something that is already a part of your life. And what I mean by that is that you're going to lose the ability to do a lot of things. Like, you're not going to be windsurfing if that's what you've done in life. You're not going to be, running track together or jogging together or working out at the gym together. You're an organ failure. So there's some things you're not going to be able to do. But is there something that you as a couple, as a family, do together that you enjoy, that you spend time together doing? You need to figure out what that is. And if you don't have one, you need to make one. Modify it to fit your situation or whatever. Create a new ritual. For us, for example, this was board gaming. We hate Monopoly. We hate Scrabble and all those, you know, kind of traditional boring games. We got plugged into what's called the new board game renaissance. And that's, if you're familiar with strategy board games like Settlers of Catan and Ticket to Ride and Wingspan, these are like kind of European style games. We had to learn these together. And we realized we could play them nearly anywhere. A board game is not very cumbersome to carry around, at least some of these newer ones. So that's what we did. And that became kind of a metaphorically a flagpole for our family. No matter where we were in what situation, and given that I was healthy enough, we could crack out a table or find a table somewhere and sit down and play a board game together. And it's something that we did regularly. It was something that we did while waiting, and that my wife could do with my kids, because there's so much waiting. You guys are going to find for your families, you're going to be having stuff done. They're going to be waiting in hospitals, restaurants, at home. You yourself are going to have a lot of downtime. You're not working. And this will, you know, again, vary for different people. But the point is, whatever this thing is for you, you as the patient need something to focus on, and the family needs something that they can do together to enjoy, so that your life is more than just hospitals and organ transplant listing. We're in a life and death situation when it's organ failure. It sucks the air out of the room. It feels like there's nothing else happening in the world, and you start to lose sight of why you're trying to survive it in the first place. So you're not wasting time if you're spending it together, thinking about, talking about something other than this crisis that you're in. You know, pick a 13 season TV show and binge it together. Or watch all the Marvel movies in order, or the Star Wars movies in order. Something you can do even in a hospital room together on a laptop. Take a free online class together in something that's ridiculous or fun or whatever. You know, figure out how to play Minecraft together, because you can do that from a hospital room online while your kids and family are at home. Even if you do it for half an hour a day, or an hour every week, and it's something everybody looks forward to. Learn whatever new thing you need to do to make that happen, and make that, or several things, your go-to thing in your downtime. Because if you don't have stuff like that, sitting around and brooding is what's going to happen. And the worst thing is to be sitting around brooding about what's going on in separate rooms with nothing to connect you. You're not going to have a lot of the normal things that maybe you had when life was normal. So if there's something you can find like that, that your family can kind of center around to very purposefully insert a distraction from the conversation of organ failure and transplant surgeries and all of that, I think it's very healthy. The fourth thing I would say, and this is more to the patient, you're probably at home now more than anyone because you're likely not working. While you're down and out, realize that even though you feel terrible physically, probably psychologically, the burden of keeping a household becomes very heavy on your spouse now, especially if your kids are young. I would strongly encourage you not to spend your time sitting and watching television. I'm a big believer that the internet is a window to the world. It's one of the ways that I stayed in touch with friends and family whenever I was extracted from my life and became sedentary and homebound or hospital bound. I kept myself busy doing something productive, and I'll talk about that more in the How to Hospital episode. Everyone's situation is different. Some people can do more than others physically at different times. I was fortunate enough that even in organ failure and heart failure, I was able to find ways to do some things to help out. Even if you've never done housework before and you are otherwise able, now is the time to pick that up. I picked up the slack as much as I could by trying to do laundry, doing dishes, sweeping the floor, things that I could do, even if it meant that I had to go take a nap afterward. None of that did anything to worsen my condition, which I understand is a different situation for everybody. What I'm saying is, do what you can to help hold down the fort. If it's ordering groceries online so your spouse is not making those trips, you know, at the very least, don't be a slob. Pick up after yourself, pick up chores where you can. It not only helps you maintain a sense of purpose, but every little thing like that you can do takes a little bit of the load off of your loved ones. If you're like me, there's a bit of guilt that everyone's life has been upended because you're sick. So one of the things you can do to lighten the load for them is to pick up the slack in those areas, even if you've never done it before. And I know, I get it. You don't feel good, but and neither did I. But I took the time to learn some things that I felt like would help us all. You might say, well, I don't know how to use a computer. Well, guess what? You're not going back to work anytime soon. You got plenty of time now to sit down and do that. I can't emphasize really how important that one thing might be. A laptop in 20 minutes on YouTube will open the door. I don't care if you're 70 years old. It'll open the door to things that you cannot imagine. Not just information about your health situation, but support groups if you need that. Online classes for anything you can imagine, free, from finance to cooking to music. I took cooking classes. I learned to cook so that I could do that. And it was, that was kind of a flagpole thing, is I would try to cook the best meal that I could. And then we sat down and ate that together at night when my wife got home from work. And it was a tradition that we kind of established, built around something that I learned how to do in that time that I had. I reject the notion that we have to be doing something productive to have inherent value as a purpose, as a person. That is a very American way of thinking. But I think there's a balance. I'm emphasizing this because if you're not doing anything with all that idle time except watching TV and staring out the window, you will inevitably start wondering, why are you even still here? It's not, I'm not saying to do these things to distract yourself from asking difficult questions or from introspecting. You need to do that as well right now, but simply being invested in or learning something and contributing something is ultimately a benefit to you. It'll benefit your family as a result, but it keeps you from just feeling like you're sitting there wasting away to nothing and not helping at all. So we can talk about, there's another, again, I know I keep saying this is another episode. There's so many digressions here we could make, but let's move on. This is going to sound cheesy as well, but I want to share it because it's also where the title of the podcast comes from. We adopted a motto. And again, this was not something that was done on purpose. I cannot imagine us standing around going, okay, we need a family motto. What will it be? And everybody casting votes and, you know, some goofy Hallmark, moment. It wasn't on purpose. Somewhere in the middle of all this, we started watching a television show called Firefly on DVD. It's a 90s era kind of space Western that ran on the Fox network, for about a single season. The story of the characters resonated so strongly with us that we watched these nine episodes or whatever they were over and over and over, especially during the years I was in the hospital. It's focused on this little ragtag group of smugglers who are just trying to survive under the rule of an oppressive government that's kind of hunting them. The captain of this group, they fly in a ship that's called, it's a Firefly class ship, and so the show's called Firefly. His name is Mal Reynolds. He's the veteran of the Civil War that the current oppressive government won. The rebels lost. He was on the side of the rebels. In the show, he is continuing to fight kind of a losing battle against this system on his own terms, and most of the time he's barely scraping by. So we really latched on to kind of his feelings of hopelessness, having kind of feeling like he was losing the war, but trying to win the battles, being the underdog, being misunderstood. There were a lot of things going on with his story that felt very much like our own at the time. In the very first episode, we see him in the final battle of that war that he lost. He's led his troops into a canyon, and he's holding down this very strategic location that would have decisively turned the war in his favor. He has lost all but about two soldiers in his unit, and he's about to be overrun. He's waiting for reinforcements. Everything seems hopeless and lost, and ultimately he does lose. But in that moment, he turns to them and he says, "We've done the impossible, and that makes us mighty." And you'll see this quote all over the internet. It's from this show. By the time we made it to the TAW implant, that quote summed up our experience almost perfectly. We began quoting it to each other all the time, in the worst of times. There's another line from the show, a paraphrase of a Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. quote that, you know, had made it somehow into this futuristic period of time, way in the future. And two of the characters who were veterans of this war said it to each other often. When you can't run, you walk. When you can't walk, you crawl. And when you can't do that, dot, dot, dot. And the characters left the last bit unspoken. Now, if you know the Dr. King quote, the original conclusion of that was, when you can't do that, you get someone to carry you. So this motto of sorts, both of these, they didn't save us. They didn't necessarily make us stronger. I'm not saying they got us through the thing, but it reminded us that we'd already done some really hard things and we were capable of doing more hard things if we needed to. That as much as the process and the waiting was trying to tear us down, and it was doing that in some ways, we were also getting stronger because of it. Something else may resonate with your family. I don't think you need a motto. I'm just sharing things that became important to us and kept us on the same page and like-minded throughout, that we could find solidarity in and say, hey, here's where we've been. Here's where we are. We are intact and we're going to get through this together. So this is not a recipe, you know, whatever these 4 or 5 points are, they're not a recipe for coming through a transplant ordeal unscathed. I'm the first to admit that all four of us should probably be in therapy to process everything that's happened. But at least we're in that situation together. We all dealt with the hardships differently, but I have 3 other people that I can now work through those hangups with. They get it because they were there. They shared all that stuff with me, the fear, the joy, the uncertainty, in a way that no one else could have. I can say that it worked because now my wife and I are going, we just celebrated 29 years of marriage. The boys are turning 20 and 16 this year. We still have that open communication. We are, at least until they get married, which I'm sure is not far off, we're the most important people in each other's lives still. And we're still rooting for one another as we're facing different challenges, as the boys are moving into new seasons of their life. My wife and I are growing in different ways. Not all of this applies to everyone or is even possible, depending on your season of life. But hopefully it gives you some insight into things that we find valuable on the backside of it, and that we credit with, coming through the whole thing intact. Thanks for listening. Take care. I'll talk to you next time.